It is really my pleasure and my honor to welcome all of you this morning to our day-long conference, God and Smog, Scholars and Religious Leaders Confront the Issues. My name is Ravi Gupta. I direct the Religious Studies program here at Utah State University, and I'm a professor in the Department of History focusing on religious studies, particularly the study of Hinduism. These introductory remarks were meant to be made by my senior colleague, Dr. Philip Barlow, who's the Arrington Chair of Mormon History and Culture. But due to a family emergency, he wasn't able to be present here with us this morning. We send our good thoughts and best wishes to him and his family. So first of all, thank you again for being here. It's a day-long conference, and we hope you'll be comfortable and be able to stay with us as long as you can. I want to take first a moment to draw your attention to this beautiful room that we are sitting in. In Hinduism in particular, there is this concept of darshan, which means seeing the divine. And that concept is used for temples and images of God, but also for the natural environment, for rivers and for mountains. And if you take a moment to look out this window, I think you can appreciate an experience of darshan right here in this room. There is just nothing more glorious, I think. I told my students last week that they ought to come to the conference just to be able to sit in this room, which is not always open and available to sit in. So please do take a moment to marvel at this beautiful natural landscape that we are privileged to live in here in Cache Valley, in Logan, and in our wonderful state of Utah. This vision here brings with it, it's bittersweet. On the one hand, it's glorious and it's beautiful on a day like this. On the other hand, we all know, if we're locals, that there are days in winter where we can stand here and not see all that much outside the window because of the challenge of smog that we have here in Utah. Occasionally some terrible air as a result of inversion in the winter. That, I think, sets the frame for what we hope to do here today at this conference, which is to really think about our global situation in the natural environment, but also to think locally in terms of where we are here today. Too often, when we speak of the environment, we forget that there are human actors who are motivated by many different factors, and few of those factors are as powerful as is religion. Religion is no doubt responsible for some of the most beautiful and powerful things that human beings have ever done. Conversely, religion is also responsible for some of the most terrible things that we inflict upon each other and our natural environment. It's a powerful, motivating, and guiding force for all of us. And at this conference, we hope to bring together these two things, God and the natural world, that is, religion and the environment together, however we might think of religion or however we might be religious, and however we might conceive of the natural world we live in. So to get us started, I want to thank a few people who have made this event possible. First of all, I want to thank Tanner Talks and the College of Humanities and Social Sciences that have provided the majority of funding for this event and made it possible for us to bring in an amazing group of speakers from all over the country and indeed the world today. Secondly, I want to thank my colleagues in the Religious Studies program, particularly the organizing committee that have worked so hard over the past year to bring this together. My colleague Dominic Sur, Dr. Philip Barlow, who's not present, Jeannie Anderson, who's back there today, and Jeannie Sur and Gary Anderson. I'm mixing up names here. Gary's right there. So this team has really brought this event together, as well as all the support we've received from others in the department, such as Melissa and Emily Perry and Amber and so on. We've had a wonderful team, and I'm really grateful to everyone, including many others who I haven't had a chance to mention this morning. I want to thank Dean Anderson for providing us this room. Another thing this room symbolizes in the John Huntsman School of Business is that in order to work through the challenges that we face in regard to the environment, we have to have partners all across various fields of work and various areas of knowledge. And our partnership with the John Huntsman School of Business, as symbolized by this room, is something that has meant a lot to us here today as well. Other than this, I want to thank our presenters for coming in from all over the country and all over the world. You'll meet each one of them, so I won't take the time to thank them individually, but you'll meet them throughout the day. There's a program available outside. If you haven't gotten one already, please feel free to pick one up. So I think with those brief thank yous and introductory remarks, I will turn quickly to our opening panel. This is a brief introductory session with three wonderful speakers, and I'll just introduce them in turn for all of you. So addressing us first is Darren Perry. Darren Perry is the chairman of the Northwest Band of the Shoshone Nation. He has served in this capacity for the last 6 years. Darren also serves as the board of directors for the American West Heritage Center in Wellsville, Utah, the Utah State Museum Board, and serves on the advisory board of the Huntsman Cancer Institute. He attended the University of Utah and Weber State University and received his bachelor's degree in secondary education with an emphasis in history. His passions in life are his family, which include his wife Melody, and 9 children and 11 grandchildren. His other passion is his tribal family. Darren wants to make sure that those who have gone before him are not forgotten. The story of the Bear River Massacre and the outcomes of that horrific event need to be remembered. He is currently working hard to raise money and awareness so an interpretive center can be built at the massacre site, so that those who have given so much are never forgotten. It is important that the Shoshone perspective is heard. It is also important to him that all people's perspectives are heard and respected. We begin with Darren because he and his people have been caring for this land before anyone else. And I think it's fitting and appropriate that he inaugurate this session today. Darren.
Good morning. Tepeyetse Nui. Welcome to the heart of Shoshone country. My name is Darren Perry. I serve as the chairman of the Northwestern Band of Shoshone Nation. Last year I spoke to 67 elementaries to share my culture. And when the fourth grade teachers introduced me as the chairman, the kids are looking around and they're not sure quite what to think. And then the first words I tell them is, what that really means is I'm the chief. And then their eyes get big. And chief is so much cooler anyway. So refer to me today as the chief. My father was Bruce Perry. His mother was May Timbimbu Perry. Her father was Moroni Timbimbu. Moroni's father was Dabuzi, which translated means rabbit, who later took the name of Jaeger after he joined the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I didn't say Mormon. And his father was Chief Sagwitch, chief of the Shoshone Nation. As I look out this window and see the beautiful landscape around us, I know why our people chose the Cache Valley to live. and to die. It's beautiful. My people are indigenous to the Cache Valley. We called this beautiful valley home for centuries. We referred to ourselves as Sosogoi, which means people who travel on foot. We were hunters and gatherers, and we traveled with the changing seasons. We looked upon the earth as not just a place to live, but something so sacred and special that we called her mother. She was always the provider of our livelihoods. To us, the mountains and the streams and the plains stand forever, and the seasons walk around annually. We traveled to different parts of this beautiful country when the game was plentiful and the seeds and berries were abundant. It was a hard way of life, as you can imagine, but it was a beautiful way of life. I'm sure we were never more than a few days away from starvation. That family relationship was sacred. Our stewardship towards this beautiful land is sacred. I want you to know my people never quarreled about religion. We were taught to love one another and be united in all things and to be grateful for all that we received. We dare not pluck a flower or twig or herb or fruit without seeking permission from the Great Spirit in prayer. We have a deep sense of interconnectedness with the natural environment. We are as much a part of the landscape as we are dependent upon its natural resources for survival. My people possess a profound spiritual kinship with nature. Pre-Columbus America was still the first Eden, a pristine kingdom. Native peoples were transparent in this beautiful landscape, always living as natural elements in the ecosphere. This is who we are. This is who we've always been. And as we start this wonderful conference, may I begin it with an old Shoshone prayer. And I'll say it in English. O Great Spirit, whose voice I hear in the winds, and whose breath gives life to the world, hear me. I come before you, one of your many children. I am small and weak. I need your strength and wisdom. Let me talk in beauty, and make my eye even behold the red and the purple sunsets. Make my hands respect the things that you have made. My ears to hear your voice in the winds. Make me wise so that I may know the things you have taught my people, the lessons that you have hidden in every rock and leaf. I seek strength, not to be superior to my brothers, but to be able to fight my greatest enemy, myself. Make me ready to come to you with clean hands and straight eyes. So when life fades, as the fading sunset every night, my spirit may come to you without shame. I'm so honored to be a part of something that is so beautiful, religious leaders and people that care for our environment, and thank you for coming, and I hope you enjoy the conference and look forward to hearing the many wonderful speakers as I am looking forward to. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Darren, for that wonderful invocation, that wonderful prayer to get us started this morning. Next, I would like to welcome Mr. Alan Matheson. Alan Matheson Jr. was confirmed as Executive Director of the Utah Department of Environmental Quality in June 2015. In addition to that role, He continues to serve as senior environmental advisor to the governor, a position he has held since October 2011. Previous to his work with the state of Utah, Matheson served as the executive director of Envision Utah, where he facilitated public processes to help communities address development and natural resource challenges in a way consistent with science, economic realities, and public values. Throughout his career, Matheson has organized and managed stakeholder groups, facilitated broad public involvement, and helped to bring divided communities together to solve controversial and complex challenges. Allen has also served as the founding director of the Utah Water Project. He was a partner in a Phoenix law firm where he specialized in natural resource and water law and was senior attorney and environmental policy advisor for Arizona's largest electric utility. It's really my pleasure and honor to invite Allen Matheson to the stage to give us some opening remarks. Please welcome him.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta. I appreciate that. It really is an honor to be here, and I'm especially grateful to be here because my son, who's a student at Utah State, is here. And it's great to see that he's out of bed at 9 o'clock. And, he's here because a professor last week said, if you come to this conference, you can get some extra credit. And he quickly texted to his brother and sister that his professor had mentioned me during the lecture. And quickly, my daughter, also an Aggie, by the way, said it must have been a history class. And then drove the point home by sending a dinosaur icon. So apparently, at Utah State, they teach everything except respect. On behalf of Governor Herbert, I want to welcome all of you to this conference and to this state. Chance to see the beauty of Utah. As we like to say, when it comes to Utah, God played favorites. Governor Herbert embraces the contributions of the faith community to our quality of life. One of his favorite activities, every year we have a luncheon for faith leaders in the state and invite dozens to come to the governor's mansion and build relationships and talk about how we can all contribute together to making life better for the people of the state. I've been privileged to facilitate some of those discussions. There's always a feeling of goodwill and shared purpose, and I already feel that here. We come from different backgrounds, our beliefs may diverge, but we do have a lot in common. Maybe chief among those, our shared sojourn here on the earth and our dependence on her life-giving bounty. I'm looking forward to this conference and learning from all of you. So as the executive director of the Department of Environmental Quality, I live in the world of environmental regulation, a world of rules, of inspections, of permits, of legislation. I use a different language, things like perfluorinated compounds, enforceable written assurance letters, micrograms per cubic meter, state implementation plans, etc. As important as regulation is in protecting our environment, the faith community has much to contribute to this dialogue. And I appreciate the fact that faith complements the vital details of science and policy with concepts such as stewardship and respect. Commonly shared religious beliefs provide a sound foundation for a salutary relationship between humans and their environment. A few examples. Religions seek to advance the human condition and to help us achieve our full potential, individually and collectively. This requires an environment that advances our capacity physically and mentally and gives us the opportunity to flourish and dedicate our best efforts to learning, to growth, to service. Religious thought and practice advances concepts of accountability and responsibility, the golden rule, making amends. These ideas suggest that we should avoid harm to others, including through our environmental footprint, and that we should clean up our messes when we make them. Many of the world's religions, maybe most, promote a special responsibility to the poor and disenfranchised. often they are the ones most impacted by pollution and environmental degradation. And most faiths teach that we should show respect for the Creator by showing respect for creation. That inspires care for our planet, our home, and the place where we accomplish the purposes of life. So while the foundational elements of religion can often help us address environmental challenges, I'd suggest that our environment, nature, provides the conditions for faith to flourish. It allows us to nurture spirituality, and therefore I would suggest that it's worthy of theological attention. Again, a few examples. Nature promotes humility. I'll try to. Maybe I can speak right in there. Does that help? Okay. Nature promotes humility. I've been tossed around on 80-foot waves in gale-force winds. I've stood at the top of a mountain peak during a storm with lightning hitting far too close and thunder rattling me to the core. I've been in a flash flood in the narrows of Paria Canyon. All those things emphasize that when it comes to the natural world, there's no place for hubris. We don't know as much as we think we do. And while it's important to advance science, we need to proceed with caution and with humility. Many of the recent natural disasters, I think, are a reminder to us that our attempts to subdue the elements are sometimes foolish arrogance. Nature surrounds us with beauty, softening, opening, and preparing hearts and souls to receive tireless wisdom. The natural world provides solitude, a respite from the increasing demands of a loud and hectic world, a place where, in quiet, away from distraction, we best hear deity's whispers. In nature, we achieve perspective. I've hiked the Grand Canyon several times and descended through Earth's strata. And they tell you that each step of that journey takes you back eons, millennia, in geological time. The short duration of my life is nothing. It's inconsequential in the vast eons represented by that chasm. And this summer, I climbed King's Peak. It's the highest point in Utah. And after summiting, we came down to a high elevation camp. And I lay out there on the ground, looking up at the heavens on a moonless night, and watched a riot of flashing lights, the overture of a meteor shower. It was an awe-inspiring experience. In the canyon and on the mountain, my trials and conflicts faded to trivia. Suddenly insignificant, I cared only about what mattered most. To me, family and faith. Finally, the majesty of creation creates respect for deity. As an artist reveals herself through her painting, God, our creator, teaches us things about his nature and character, I think, through creation. We can see the mathematical precision of solar orbits, the complex chemistry of life, the simple yet profound beauty of a sunset. The stunning splendor of the earth give us a suggestion of a being of boundless intellect, boundless artistry. It tells me something else about God. I would suggest that beauty is not necessary to fulfill the purposes of the earth. The earth could sustain life. We could have necessary experiences here without the beauty. But I think that it's a gift from God, a statement of a caring father that I see in the color, forms, and diversity of the earth. So there's a reason that throughout history, spiritual leaders and seekers of God's wisdom have gone to mountaintop and to wilderness. Let me end with a final thought. A few years ago, I took my kids down to southern Utah. My mother-in-law, their grandmother, had died that week. And we hiked into Delicate Arch at midnight on a moonless night, or a full moon night. It was a scene that I will never forget. And we took a moment there, and I suggested that the light and beauty we saw were reflective of their grandmother's good life. We offered a simple prayer of gratitude for her and her good life. And then as we were about to turn and leave, a flashing shooting star flew across the arch. Some would call that a coincidence. I choose to view it as a loving response. So in the world of environmental policy, we think about balance, balancing the need for natural resources for society against the social and environmental impacts of obtaining those resources. We often conduct cost-benefit analyses. In my experience, the most undervalued natural resource is wonder. I wish you the best in this conference as we together become more enlightened. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alan, for those wonderful remarks, and particularly for the reminder about humility in the face of the natural world. I think all of us here living in Utah can share that sense of wonder and the sense of smallness that we feel in front of the grandeur of nature. So thank you so much for that. Now it's my pleasure and honor to introduce Mayor Holly Daines. Holly Hubbard Daines was elected to Logan City's Municipal Council in 2009 and has served on many city committees and boards. Daines grew up in Cache Valley, attended Logan High School, graduated magna cum laude from Utah State University. Let me repeat that once more. Graduated magna cum laude from Utah State University. And received a master's degree in arts administration from the University of Utah. We won't dwell long on that one. She worked for arts organizations in Salt Lake and New York City, returning to Logan with her husband Peter in 1989. Prior to her election to city council, she volunteered extensively with local schools. While she raised her three children, served on the Cliffsides Parks Committee, the Dean's Advancement Council for USU's College of Humanities, Arts, and Social Sciences, and was a founding trustee of the Eccles Theater Capital Arts Alliance. We are so grateful that she has made the time to be here today with us despite her busy schedule, and for all the support that she gives to the Aggie family. Mayor Daines.
Good morning. I echo the wonderful comments that have been made as we look out the window and enjoy this spectacular scene. And I think that's why we're all here. As mayor of Logan, I am here just to give a brief welcome to you. We're so happy to have you in Cache Valley. And as mayor, I feel a responsibility, as many of you do, to try and preserve this for future generations. As we work on projects for the city, whether it's talking about Main Street with UDOT or a possible downtown development, and we engage the citizens, things that the priorities that come up are, this is our home, our community. We want it to be wonderful for our family. And again, I think as a woman of faith, I'm just very happy to participate, and I think we need to approach the challenges of our environment from every angle that we possibly can. So thank you for being here in Logan to discuss this, and I wish you the best, and I pledge to participate in doing all I can. But I think we also need to remember that that principle of loving thy neighbor as thyself really sort of expands to the environment, and how we treat the environment does affect us and our neighbors. So again, thank you very much. Welcome to Logan, to our guests, and thank you very much.
Please give a round of applause again to all three of our wonderful panelists here in this introductory session. So as we get started with our first panel, just a couple of really quick introductory or housekeeping matters. The way this will work is we have two panels during the day. The first panel will begin in just a couple of minutes. Each presenter will have about 30 minutes to do the presentation, including some discussion amongst the panelists on the stage. After that, which will take a couple of hours, we have a break, and then an opportunity for everyone everyone in the audience to get involved in asking questions and participating with the audience. We have a student volunteer in the rows here. Alexandra Bobella. She's a really brilliant religious studies major, and she has index cards with her. So if you think of a question along the way, please grab an index card from her or get one during the break. Write down your questions and hand them to the moderator for the next session, which will be Dr. Dominic Sir. Let me just end and leave you with this thought as we move into the next panel. Karl Marx made his very famous remark that religion is an opiate of the masses, something that is successful in dulling the minds of the poor people and keeping them away from action, keeping them absorbed and distracted in their lives of petty pursuits. We have an opportunity here, and let me ask this question. Was Karl Marx right? And particularly in regard to the environment, today we have an opportunity to perhaps prove him wrong in some way, to show that religion can be not just a way to keep people quiet and hidden away and distracted and dull, which it certainly can occasionally, but it's also a force for action and for change. And what we hope will happen in today's conference is not just that you will get wonderful information from the great work that these panelists are doing in regard to religion and the environment, but also that you will see up here on the stage a model of what good conversation looks like. We live in a world where conversation about religion and sadly about the environment is complicated and controversial. And we need examples of how to do those conversations well. So I invite you to listen in on these conversations as they happen today, but I also invite you to participate and become part of that conversation. Thank you all so much again for being here. And at this point, I'll hand it to my colleague, Dr. Dominic Sir.
Thank you. Good morning to you all. Can everyone hear me all right? Okay. Thank you. I would like to invite our next panel up. We have four distinguished scholars, Dr. Darlington, Dr. Habermas, Dr. Barker, Dr. Hanley. Please approach stage and have a seat. That's right. We want to show Dr. Darlington's photographs during her presentation. Several people, actually. So is that available through this? Can someone? Oh, I see. Maybe we could. That's right. Maybe we could lower the shade just a little bit to see the screen better because we're showing some photographs. Is that possible? Okay, we'll work on it. In the meantime, again, introducing myself just briefly, I'm Dominic Sir. I'm an instructor in the Department of Religious Studies, and I would just like to welcome you all here. It's very good to see you. We have four distinguished scholars of religion whose work, in some significant sense, is important for our conference today. These are scholars who look at the intersection of religion and ecological and environmental engagement. So I would like to move to our first panelist, and perhaps it looks like we will have a little bit of shade just in time. Let me begin by introducing our first speaker. Dr. Sue Darlington is a professor of anthropology and Asian studies at Hampshire College. She is also dean of the School of Critical Social Inquiry. Her teaching focuses on environmental anthropology and Buddhism and society. She has an emphasis in her work on what is known widely as socially engaged Buddhism. She received her PhD from the University of Michigan in 1990 and has taught at Hampshire College ever since. She's currently chair of the Thailand-Laos-Cambodia Group of the Association for Asian Studies. Dr. Darlington's book, The Ordination of a Tree, the Thai Buddhist Environmental Movement, which is available to be seen along with the books from our other panelists out in the foyer, was published by SUNY Press in 2012 and translated into the Thai language in 2015. This book is based on Dr. Darlington's extensive research in Thailand with Buddhist monks who undertake conservation and rural development projects based on their interpretation of Buddhist discourse and scriptures. Her new research aims to extend this project comparatively across other Buddhist societies in Asia, possibly including the United States. And she's examining comparative perspectives of how Buddhists in different societies view the environment and whether and how they engage Buddhism for environmental work. Dr. Darlington.
Thank you. Should I stand or sit? I think I'd prefer to stand. Get my timer to go, because otherwise you won't hear the other panelists. I want to thank you so much for the invitation to speak here today. I want to begin in particular by thanking Chief Darren Perry of the Shoshone Nation for reminding us of the first people who walked this land and cared for this land that we are on today. That's deeply moving to me, because I, as an environmental anthropologist, what I look at is people's relationship with the land and how they think about the land. I also want to thank the organizers of the conference today. It's so important. This is such a critical topic, and I know a lot of people have put a lot of time and energy into making this happen. And for me, actually, I asked for the shades for the so you could see the photos, but actually, so I'm not distracted by the view, because I think I would keep stop talking and just stare. I'm from Massachusetts. We do not have this kind of view in Massachusetts. I look at Buddhism and the relationship with the environment through the lens of Buddhism as a lived religion. By that, I mean the ways in which specific people interpret the teachings that they have, the way they've been raised, for particular contexts and situations. Religion gives us a basic core set of teachings, but how people take those teachings and put them into practice in their daily lives can vary dramatically from person to person, from group to group, from situation to situation. So I'm interested in how the teachings of Buddhism are being used in Thailand by Buddhist monks and by the farmers and villagers they work with to think about and act on the issues of the environment. So I want to start with, okay, I think I probably have to aim this somewhere. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll scoot down there and that's fine. Yep. No worries. The Buddhist monks have to be adaptable. I have to be adaptable as well. I want to start with a story. The monk in the middle here is Prakrupitak Nantukun. He is a Buddhist monk in northern Thailand who is very engaged throughout his life in thinking about environmental issues. And I've heard him over the years. I've known him since 1991. Tell a story about why he became a monk, why he's concerned about the natural environment. He tells a story of going hunting with his father when he was around 8 years old. He lived in rural northern Thailand in the jungle, and his family depended on the natural resources of the jungle to have their livelihood. So one of the things his father did was hunt. And as a young boy, Pitak would accompany his father into the jungle. And he tells the story of how one day they were going through the very thick canopy. There was a rustling up in the top of the trees, and his father shot a lango monkey. And the monkey fell from the canopy down to the ground. And his father asked the boy to go and collect the monkey, as this was going to be meat that they could eat and sell. As Petak approached the monkey, however, he saw movement. And he realized that his father had shot a mother langur, and the baby was clinging to its dead mother's skin. The father was going to kill the baby as well, and Petak pleaded with him to let him raise the baby monkey. And his father agreed. They took the dead mother and the baby back, the live baby, back to their village. And the baby was put in a cage in front of their house while the father prepared the mother monkey and, among other things, splayed her skin out to dry. For 3 days, Petak tried to feed the baby, and all it did was cry. It refused to eat, and it was beginning to suffer dramatically. He finally decided that the only chance this baby was going to live was for him to release it, which he did. And immediately, the baby monkey, went around the house to cling to the skin of its dead mother, splayed in the back. He tells this story because it explains why he became a monk, why he became interested in the natural environment and the human impact on it. It helps us understand the connection between Buddhist ideals and environmental problems and the actions people take to deal with them. So I look at his story as a way in to understanding these issues. He became a monk from this story because of the baby langur's suffering and his realization that it was caused by his father's and his own actions. And one of the primary goals of Buddhism is to relieve suffering. In strict philosophical interpretations, the main focus of ending suffering is to get humans out of, and all sentient beings out of, the cycle of birth, growing old, getting sick, and dying. Buddhists believe in reincarnation, and we are in the cycle of birth, growing old, getting sick, and dying. So the ultimate goal is to get out of that through your spiritual realization and attainment. So from a philosophical point of view, the concern about the natural world is an attachment to this cycle and keeps us in this cycle rather than helping us to escape it. And he recognized from the suffering of the monkey, the suffering that needs to be relieved, and dedicated his life to becoming a monk. But the story of the baby langur also shows a very tangible suffering. And Petak became interested in the impact of humans on the natural environment, not in order to escape the world. He became a monk in order to help people relieve suffering of themselves and others in the immediate world. So since his childhood in northern Thailand and his awareness of impact on the natural environment, he was watching from the 1960s, when he was a child, the changes in the mountains of his home. And I realized last night driving in here that this particular photograph will not have the impact here that it has in many places, because this is meant to show you deforestation in Thailand. In Thailand, even when I began my research in the early 90s there, you would see nothing but trees in this image. And now, even this picture's a little old, and there are very few trees. But then I looked out here and realized your natural mountains look a little bit like the deforestation in northern Thailand. So this is a dramatic photo for most people in other places. But he watched these changes over his life. And he became concerned not only about the changes on the natural world, but also the changes on humans. He lived in the rural area where most people were farmers, and they still are farmers. And he was concerned that as the forest disappears, you have numerous consequences. You have the loss of water, drought, cycles of drought, and severe flooding because the trees are not holding the water into the ground. And farmers became participants in this because the government and large seed companies in particular were really encouraging the farmers to start growing cash crops. The government in Thailand in the 1960s took an economic policy of agricultural export as an industry and encouraged farmers to stop growing for subsistence, but more growing crops that could be sold. In the province where I work, this is largely maize, feed maize, that would be sent to other parts of Thailand and overseas to feed cattle and pigs. So they no longer grow their own food, but they were growing, sending this to feed people in places elsewhere. And they would get caught in a cycle of debt as a consequence, because if they didn't have a good crop, the companies would extend the loans they gave them, and they would cut down more and more trees to expand what they were growing. So you think, how does that have anything to do with Buddhism? And the explanation that these monks come up with is that they look to Buddhist principles to both explain the problem and to find ways out of the problem. So Pitak would describe this as being caused by the three root evils in Buddhism, which are greed or desire, hatred or anger, and ignorance or delusion. And he would say these kinds of root evils in society would become the motivation for continuing to seek more and more money, to seek more and more taking advantages of the natural world for individual and corporate good, for their own good, not for the good of the people. And so he could see the impact this had on farmers and on the natural land. So he and other monks decided to start from the ground up and to listen to the farmers to try to understand their problems. So this monk, Prakru Manat, listened to farmers say that there was continuing drought year after year that he saw going hand in hand with logging concessions in their area. And as these companies cut down the forest, the water was disappearing. So he worked with the farmers to find ways of changing the situation and trying to use ritual practices to get the farmers to understand how much they depend on nature and to help them realize they could have agency to get out of this cycle of debt and environmental damage. And he would do things like long life rituals for rivers. And in 1988, he performed an adaptation of a ritual that is usually to consecrate a Buddha image, but in this time he did it to ordain the largest tree remaining in the forest. By this, he wrapped orange robes around the tree in order to make people realize that just as people have to take care of the monks, the leaders of their religious tradition, and the monks would take care of the people, the followers, same people need to take care of the natural environment symbolized by a tree, and the nature would provide for the people in return. So they did not consider themselves making these trees monks. That's very important to realize. They were doing this symbolically to use the ritual practice and get people's commitments to programs, to projects. Because just doing a ritual in and of itself is not enough. That will help remind people of the basic core values taught by the religion, but that in itself does not get people to necessarily practice those values. And so they also would be doing programs, projects, such as helping farmers to gradually shift from growing one single crop for cash to turning their fields back into subsistence farming, little by little growing food to eat first, and if there's anything left over, to be able to sell it. And growing different types of food mixed together, types of plants and animals, because they help each other. Nitrogen growing, producing peas next to corn that needs the nitrogen, pigs and chickens running around below, fish in the rice paddy fields, so the water that floods the rice paddies would have fish in it. And it was to help the farmers to begin to take control of their own lives and their own situation, get them out of a cycle of debt by producing their own food and having a positive income impact on the forest itself and the natural environment. So wrapping an orange robe around a tree helps people think about their the moral responsibility to care for the forest and the beings in it and the natural world of which the forest is part of. So they would connect the integrated agricultural projects with the ritual. And people would, you could do projects on your own. You could say, yes, we're going to use the scientific studies to get people to change their agricultural practice. But by combining it with a religious ritual, by reminding people of the values of compassion and loving kindness and taking care of other beings, people have more of a commitment to actually going through with the project and making the changes. They also get religious merit towards their future rebirth to have a better life and eventually get out of the cycle of rebirth. So one of the questions that I ask in my research, I borrow from a scholar named Malcolm David Eccle. After examining critiques of Buddhism and environment, he asks the question, what to do about the environment? And what to do about the environment from a Buddhist point of view. He continues to answer the following. The answer is to become enchanted once again by the symbols and let the symbols give rise to thought. The challenge is to appropriate the symbolic resources of the tradition while acknowledging that this appropriation has no inevitability. It is simply an act of imaginative reconstruction, as if one were shaping a new landscape out of the mixed and contradictory residue of Buddhist tradition. This is done through reinterpreting Buddhist practice and rituals in light of both the human and nature relationship and how practical applications of the teachings together with concrete programs can help relieve the suffering of farmers and connect them to the teachings in a society that is becoming increasingly secular. And this is being done throughout the Buddhist world. So I've delved into Thailand and the use of a tree ordination ritual to promote people to think about the impact of agricultural practices on the natural landscape, and that you can change those practices and still have a good livelihood, but take care of the environment at the same time using Buddhist values of compassion and loving kindness and equanimity. But this is not the only place it's done. It's done in Cambodia, where there's a monk in the northwest who's been trying to create parks to take care of the land there. And he's won the United Nations Ecuador Prize for Environment. It's done in Japan and everywhere where the group Nipiso Myohoji has gone around the world, where they chant and drum for the sake of all people in the world. And they also challenge nuclear energy and nuclear weapons in particular, and say we need to be aware of the impact humans have on the world. In South Korea, there is a practice called Three Steps and a Bow, and it was done where people went on a 450-kilometer walk across the country. Two different sects of Buddhists plus Christian groups, where they would take literally three steps and a bow in order to bring attention to a wetlands reclamation area that was going to destroy the wetlands, the birds, the whales, the animals that in that coastal area depended on that natural environment. Another South Korean nun was trying to use the religion to bring attention to the impact of building a bullet train through a mountain that would destroy the environment of that mountain. That was a sacred place where people would go for the peace and quiet and solitude, but also provided water for the surrounding area. The watershed in that mountain was threatened by this project. And she went on a hunger strike in 2005 to protest this the building of this train. Unfortunately, she was unsuccessful. The wetlands project was successful. They did stop that project. In her case, they did not, but she has not stopped raising environmental issues. Tibetans have devoted themselves to protecting the environment quite a bit, and I think we'll hear a little bit about the Tibetan Buddhist perspective this afternoon. These pictures are taken from a film called Patyatra, A Green Odyssey, in which an important Buddhist leader led a group of people for quite a long distance, I don't have the exact amount in their case, across parts of the Himalayas, collecting trash and documenting the pollution in this very remote area that people have still had a problem, had an impact on. So that's a practical aspect. And one of the main Tibetan Buddhist leaders, His Holiness the Karmapa, the 17th Karmapa, has also used his position as a Buddhist leader in order to promote people's awareness of their impact. And he talks here, the quote, "Whatever it is that I do, I want it to have a long-term visible impact and for it to be practical. If I have the opportunity, I would most like to restore the natural environment in the Himalayas and Tibet, and especially to protect the forest, the water, and the wildlife of this region." And he goes on to point out that all the major religions share the same founding principles of living simply, acting compassionately, and treating each other with kindness. Importance of stewardship of nature. So I just want to close here saying that these examples are just a few of what Buddhist leaders around the world and Buddhist people around the world are doing. This is not the majority of Buddhists in the world, but they are people that are using the teachings and the values of the religion to promote an alternative way of interacting and caring for the earth, recognizing our mutual dependence upon each other. So I will leave you with that, and I thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much, Dr. Darlington. That was a fascinating presentation. Before we proceed, do any of the other panelists have any questions or comments? If not, I have one brief question for you, Dr. Darlington. You mentioned that there's been some reconfiguration and a kind of transformation of some Buddhist symbolism in the service of environmental engagement. And you said that this has to be done self-consciously with a kind of awareness that there's no inevitability of this symbolic reappropriation. So my question is, in light of the requirement that this be a self-conscious reappropriation of Buddhist symbolism by environmentally engaged Buddhists, are there any conflicts? Are there conservative Buddhist factions who see such symbolic reappropriation as not only not inevitable, but as problematic?
Thank you for that question. That's really there is a lot of conflict within the idea of using Buddhism in this way. Just within Thailand, the monk that I mentioned that was listening to his villagers about the drought that was coming from logging, the alternating drought and flooding, when he performed the first tree ordination, he was in 1988, He was denounced. He was written up in newspapers as being crazy. There were many members of the Buddhist Sangha, the monkhood, who said he should be kicked out. He should be disrobed, stop being a monk, because he was misusing the Buddhist teachings. And part of that was surrounding the misunderstanding that people thought he was actually ordaining a tree, that he thought the tree could become a monk. But they also were against it. There's a lot of critique saying, this kind of use of Buddhism is anachronistic. It's trying to project back an idea of Buddhism as being connected to the natural world, saying that the Buddha himself, 2,500 years ago, was aware of the natural world and cared about it. And there was no environmental crisis at that time. This is what the critiques will claim. They say it's a simplification of Buddhist teachings and that it creates dualism between people and nature. And the Buddhists would say, a strict Buddhist teaching is the goal is to get out of the cycle of rebirth, not to stay attached to it and try to correct it in this world. So this kind of critique is what these monks are up against. And they would argue in return that the Buddha was very aware of and very connected with the natural world. No, he did not teach about pollution and logging and cash cropping as being problems, because they weren't problems in India at that time. But the world changes, and the religion needs to change with it.
Thank you so much. Our next speaker is Dr. David Haberman, who received his PhD in the history of religions from the University of Chicago and is currently professor of religious studies at Indiana University Bloomington. Although Dr. Haberman studied and taught a great variety of religious traditions, he specializes in the tradition of Hinduism and has spent many years conducting ethnographic and textual research in India. Much of his work is centered on the culture of Braj, the active pilgrimage site long associated with Krishna and known for its lively temple festivals, performative traditions, and literary creations. Related publications by Dr. Habermas include Acting as a Way of Salvation, a study of Raganuja Bhakti Sadhana, and an annotated translation of the Bhaktira Samrita Sindhu of Rupa Goswamin. That's all those years of college right there. Haberman also teaches courses on religion, ecology, and environmentalism. His present research interests track the relationship between religion, ecology, and nature, with attention towards sacred land and Hindu attitudes towards non-human activities. His recent work focuses on the worshipful interaction with natural forms of divinity in India, such as rivers, trees, stones, and mountains. Publications addressing these interests include Journey Through the 12 Forests, An Encounter with Krishna, River of Love in the Age of Pollution, the Yamuna River of Northern India, and People Trees, Worship of Trees in Northern India. He is currently working on a new book titled Loving Stones, Making the Impossible Possible in the Worship of Mount Govardhan, and a new research product on religion and the challenges of climate change related to glaciers and rivers in the Indian Himalayas called Angry Gods and Raging Rivers, the Changing Climate of the Central Himalayas. Dr. Haberman.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Is this working? Yeah. This is my first time to Logan and Utah State University, and I'm delighted to be here. I grew up in Colorado, just to the southeast of here, and I'm living in southern Indiana these days, and although that's also a gorgeous place, we don't have mountains like these, so I'm happy to be here. I'm also delighted to be part of this conference, and I'm feeling a gratitude to all those people who helped put it on. I'll be talking about faces today, and the face of that large crowd for me is Professor Ravi Gupta. So thank you, Ravi, the director of the Religious Studies program here, for inviting me. I was asked to speak on Hinduism and ecology. And that is a vast ocean. And to avoid the risk of drowning in that vast ocean, rather than focusing on generalities and kind of abstract notions, I thought I would speak about a specific tradition within Hinduism that I think has much to offer. One of the major themes, at least, that was articulated to me in this conference, which is a consideration of ourselves, the world, and our relationship with the world. I would suggest that one of the major causes of the environmental crisis that we are in today is a loss of significant relationships with the larger world, the non-human world, the other than human world, however we want to refer to that, and that devotional Hinduism has a great deal to offer, both in terms of a worldview as well as a set of practices that are about establishing and enhancing connection or relationships. So again, the theme that I took to one of the major themes of the conference is a reconsideration or a consideration of ourselves, the world, and our relationship with it. So what exactly is the world? If I've learned anything as a lifelong student of religion, is that that answer is, that question is answered in a great, great variety of ways. Within, I would say, a worldview that is shared by a great number of Hindus, has it that the world is, the word often is used is advaitic, that is, it is non-dual. It is a world that is radically interconnected. But that unity of the world is a composite unity that both accounts for the bountiful diversity of the world, as well as a radical unity of the world, the simultaneity of those two positions, called in Sanskrit bheda-bheda, and to put a term on that. So that one finds in foundational texts like the Upanishads, a major scripture within Hinduism, statements such as sarvam kalvidam brahma, that is, that all this is Brahman, all this is that ultimate reality, or to put it in terms of the Gita, Vasudevaha sarvam, that God, that everything is an aspect of divinity. So we'll see that Hinduism is a tradition that recognizes both the realm of form and the manifest world, the world we experience with our senses, as well as a world that is completely beyond that and transcends that. Both of these concepts are found within Hindu tradition. And the realization is called Sarvatma Bhav, one of four Sanskrit terms that I'm going to use today. They all begin with an S, so we're going to talk about the four S's. This notion that God is everything and everything as God. Gandhi, who is recognized as one of the great leaders of Indian environmentalism, said that everything is one, and that totality of that one, the summation of all everything is a major, major aspect of divinity. But again, this is a composite notion. So this is really the only word slide that I'm putting up here this morning. And what we're seeing is pairs of Sanskrit terms where the one on the right is negated by the one on the left with a prefix a. Sanskrit, like English, will negate a noun with the prefix a, like in moral, amoral, historical, ahistorical, functioning like that. So murta means form, and form is always plural. Amurta is the formless. Vyakta is manifest. Avyakta is unmanifest. Sakar means with form, with shape, with substance. Nirakar means without that shape. Kshara is a changing world. The world that we experience out here is changing, as we see easily. And akshara, the unchanging. Saguna, with qualities. Nirguna, without qualities. Swarup is a particular form. Say more about that one. Or Vishvarup is the universal form. I might also add to that, we could put on the right-hand side the immanent, to use a theological term, and the transcendent on the left. So this is the what I mean by the composite unity that Hinduism expresses. And I offer students to a way of thinking about that more, the simple exercise of thinking about the double meaning of the rather simple phrase, nothing ever remains the same. So nothing ever remains the same because things are always changing. But what is it that ever remains the same? And the answer is there, and that is nothing. But I do want to point out that it is very difficult to connect with nothingness. Right, with the void. And that we are wired as human beings with the, it is much easier for us to connect with form. And one of the teachers in this culture for me once said a phrase that I've come to use as almost a mantra in thinking about this tradition. He says that the devotional tendency is to draw out form and personality from the formless. And indeed, form is easier to connect with. So here is a form. I would say that the major practice within Hinduism is called Murti Puja in Sanskrit, what I would translate as the worshipful interaction with embodied forms of divinity. So anyone familiar with temple Hinduism knows that when one goes into a Hindu temple, one finds interaction with an embodied form such as this one. This is Radharaman, a form of Krishna in the pilgrimage center of Vrindavan. But today I want to focus on these murtis. These are also murtis. These are natural murtis taken from my front porch at a house I live in from time to time up in the Himalaya. And here we're seeing mountains, trees, and we can't see, but the Ganges is down below a river. How does one connect with those? Environmental psychologists tell us that we care about the things that we are connected to. How does one then connect with something like a mountain? Well, I would like to exemplify this with the case of Mount Govardhan, which is a 7-mile-long rocky ridge located in north-central India that has been worshipped for centuries and centuries as an embodied form of Krishna, one of the supreme Hindu divinities. And this is a religion that aims to establish connection or relationship, maybe to use the other word that I brought out in the conference theme. How does one relate to a mountain? Before I move off this slide, the bottom part is saying Shri Giriraj Dharana Ki Jai, which has a double meaning. It can mean either the all glory be to the one who takes the, or one who lifts the mountain, one who holds the mountain, and I'll explain that here in a moment, as well as one who takes the form of the mountain. So there's a story. Religion often is a storytelling human endeavor, and the story in brief behind this particular picture is that the villagers growing up in a pastoral situation, every autumn would collect a grand amount of the food from the harvest to offer to Indra, the god of storms, the god of rains. And one day Krishna approached his father and said, why are we actually doing that? The gods don't actually have that much of an influence on our lives, gods like Indra. Rather, if we want to offer this food to anything as a worshipful offering, we should offer to Mount Govardhan, because our water comes from that mountain. The grass to feed our cows comes from that mountain. That mountain really sustains us. So Krishna ends up leading a worship of that mountain, offering the food that was set aside for Indra to the mountain rather than to Indra. Indra becomes very angry and causes a horrific storm that lasted for 7 days and seven nights. And the people were frightened and went to Krishna for some kind of response to that. And he did respond by holding up the mountain. So much could be said about that story, but what I want to show here is that, or highlight, is that we're seeing two Krishnas here. The one who is holding the mountain and the one is who has held the mountain up. The one who conducted the worship and the one who was the receiver of the worship. They have an identity. And what comes out of this, again, is the notion that the mountain itself is an embodied form of divinity for this tradition. Before I leave it, in all artistic representations, the mountain is shown as a conglomeration of, it appears to be, individual stones. How does one connect with something like this? And we are seeing a piece of that mountain. How does a human being connect with that? This, all right. There's a way of interacting with the mountain as a whole. And this is called parikrama, a way of circumambulating the mountain clockwise. And one can walk around it, or we just saw how people can move by bowing. In this case, there's a way of going around the mountain by prostrating fully and then moving one's body forward a body length. It takes about 10 days to go around the 14-mile circumambulatory pathway around the mountain, an embodied way of interacting with an embodied form of divinity. Or occasionally one finds a rock hugger. India is the land from which the term tree hugging came from the Chipko movement, that where women would hug trees in the Himalayas to save them. But going back to the mountain, how does one connect really in an intimate way with a mountain? And the about 1.5 billion years ago, this mountain was produced when there was a tectonic upliftment of the purple quartzite the mountain is made from, fracturing the mountain horizontally and vertically, and creating, in effect, a conglomeration of individual stones. The individual stones from the mountain are considered to be embodied forms of the mountain. And one can approach the mountain through a particular stone. As one man explained to me, if I were to prick you with a pin, would you say I'm pricking your body? And I would say yes. And he said, if I pricked you in the arm, would you say yes? If I pricked you in the foot, would you say yes? If I pricked you in the top of the head, would you say yes? And I would nervously say yes to all of those. His point was, wherever you were approach the mountain, in whatever form, the whole mountain receives that. We as human beings are, in a sense, hardwired to relate to others through particularity. Universal love is a very noble concept, and we need much, much more of it in the world today. But we know that the kind of love that rivets us, that draws our attention, is love for a particular being. So we're moving from universality to particularity here. And indeed, most of the interaction with the mountain takes place with individual forms. Here's one in the forest itself. Or I want to move to talk about the concept of a swarup. Here we're seeing interaction with one of the stones from the mountains in the context of a home shrine. And the term swarup has an expedient double meaning, in that it means literally own form. From the divine's perspective, it's considered to be an essential form of God, God's own form. This isn't really symbolic representation. The stone is considered to be an embodied form of divinity. From the worshiper's perspective, that's the worshiper's own form. That's the particular form in which God comes to a particular worshiper, a particular devotee, for the particular relationship. So that is going to change from individual to individual. And the best way, rather than talking about this as symbolic behavior or symbolic interaction, I think another term that is often used is metonymic representation, where the example is the relationship between a cup and a handle on a cup. The handle on the cup is not exactly the cup, but it's not the cup either. The handle on the cup is a part of the cup that allows you to get a handle on the cup. And again, the cup that I'm talking about in this context is the infinite. So it is a particular form of the infinite itself. Well, again, let me move through some of my examples. These are bare rocks that are worshipped, signs of worship, dressed up in elaborate fashions. But I want to move more towards, this one was obviously selected because of the face. You see the eye and the mouth there in the face. But everything changes when eyes are added. And the anthropologist Alfred Gell said that when eyes are added to some object, it opens up and gives access to interiority. The eyes are so important. We know that lovers connect through the eyes. And the deep, intimate interaction takes place through the eyes. And indeed, babies, newborn babies, track schematic diagrams of eyes from the day they are born. So deep interconnection. Ravi had mentioned the Hindu word darshan, which means seeing. I think it actually is better translated as visual communion. Because it's not only seeing divinity, it is also being seen by divinity. It's that deep participation in relationship that happens through the eyes. And indeed, eyes are sold in the bazaar for such purposes. Well, a major feature of the worshipful interaction with Govardhan stones involves the anthropomorphic enhancement of the stone. And the worshippers say that this is done to create and establish intimate relationships. What do we learn if we take that seriously? Again, they say that the stone is dressed up in this fashion, particularly with the eyes, enhanced in this way, to deepen relationship, to deepen the sense of the divine presence. The divine presence is always there, with or without the ornamentation, but the ornamentation is said to amplify that divine presence and make it much more evident. Variety of stones. There's a consensus in the fields of evolutionary, developmental, and neuropsychology these days that human beings are born with face recognition. We are hardwired to connect through the human face. And I think we see that being played out here. So important for a species such as the human. Faces. And here we see identification between Krishna and the Govardhan stone very keen. How again does one connect with such a stone? And here we see an act of seva. Seva are loving acts. We know that if someone comes to us and screams in our face in harsh ways, we tend to draw back and conceal ourselves from such a person. On the other hand, if someone comes in a very loving fashion, treats us with love, we come out and we reveal ourselves. Well, perhaps it's that way with all things in the world. So these loving acts of service are the way to enter into that loving relationship in which the divine presence is revealed and the relationship is further enhanced. The home shrines tend to be the environments in which the most intimate interaction take place in the privacy of the home shrine. So here's Lakshmi before her home shrine. She added that she thinks everyone should worship a stone about the size of their own heart. Again, a gesture towards an intimate connection. And here's her swarup, her particular form that she worships. This man that we're looking at has worshipped these stones for 30 years. And he told me one day that he was worshipping the stone, the individual particular stone. That stone, he had a vision where that stone became non-different from the entire mountain. And his vision didn't stop there. Then that whole mountain became non-different from the entire land of Braj. And that became non-different from all of India, which became non-different from the whole world. So we see here that there is an approach to the universal through the particular. So that the particular, again, by making a deep, deep connection with the particular, there's an avenue that opens up for a deep connection with the totality. I'm going to have to move really quickly because I see my time is basically up here. I could have illustrated these same things with trees. Here's a tree that I live near in Benares. And I guess the point I want to make that I haven't made yet is if anyone tried to cut down a tree that is being worshipped like this, there would be a riot. So this is a way certainly of protecting those. Lots of ritual ways of interconnecting with these trees that I could speak on too long. I'm going to mention this one. A new hotel was built on the Ghats of Benares, and their hotel could have been expanded if they were to just simply cut down this tree. And when I suggested that to the manager, he was horrified, and he said, our business would have been destroyed immediately if that's true. We honor this tree. Why would we do that? The most intimate interaction with trees happens to be with the neem trees. We're hearing about this more and more in medicines in the West. It is actually called the village pharmacy in India. But again, the techniques that I've been talking about of ornamentation and the face in particular as a point of connection is there. This is interfacing with nature, again, for those deep relationships. Here's a man in his candy store with a neem tree growing out of the center, again, just to maybe drag him. I said, well, if you cut that tree down, you're going to have much more room. And he, again, was horrified of that and said, my family would be ruined if we were to do that. So maybe let me wrap it up in just saying that Sarvatma, the notion that everything is God and God is everything, but the Swarup is that particular form. And the way one connects with the particular is through seva, those loving acts, which establishes a deep relationship, some bond. And it's through a relationship with the particular that one then comes to, I had this explained with a tree, that first it's worship of a particular tree leads to a realization of the divine nature of all trees, and then finally in all life. So this again is an avenue into the reverence of all life. And with that then we are a return to the black slide that I began with. And in this case, we are seeing the face of the personality of the particular on the void that gives one that deep access, that deep relationship with the particular that is realized as being non-different from the totality. So once again, moving from the particular to a reverence with all life. Let me stop there.
Thank you. That was incredible. Thank you, Dr. Hibman. Quite interesting. I could just rattle off more questions. But if any of our panelists have any questions or comments at the moment?
I was really looking forward to hearing this talk because often my students will This is some very interesting distinctions between the two talks. I was really fascinated with the idea of adding the eyes to give a window to the interiority. Buddhists will worship specific trees, but you know, the idea that you're not, when you wrap robes around them, you are not an insight to that specific tree that then is part of the larger forest and the larger world, but it really is playing on the symbolism and the idea of the human nature relationship is dramatically different in these, even when you see the trees wrapped in the colorful robes in your pictures are very similar to what you'll see with trees in temples in Southeast Asia that are wrapped in multicolored and are worshipped, but in many ways more as symbolism rather than being the divine itself. And I find that a very interesting distinction. And yet we can see how both ways in help the humans think about their own connection with nature and the importance of that. So playing on these rituals to remind us at this crisis moment with the environment, that we can turn to these for getting that inspiration. So thank you for that. It was really, I found that fascinating.
Just a brief addition. I recently talked to my students about Hinduism, and this—it's this common word comes up. This word, polytheism, many godded, and often students they're somewhat perplexed. They right, there's how are there so many gods? And in scriptures like the Upanishads, there are passages that seem to say, well, there are millions of gods, there are thousands of gods. There's one god. There's one and a half gods. There's no. So it's very paradoxical. And one thing that I think was well evinced in your talk, and a very nice contrast made with your comment, is that the polytheistic imagination is actually a radical affirmation of wholeness, right? When everything is divine, there's no division. So we might, you know, as beginners, we might think of the polytheistic imagination as one in which there's countless divine things, and which one do we pay attention to? It's actually a radical affirmation of the total wholeness of things. So that the common distinction between sacred and profane, often made in religions, is it can be seen as largely absent in this viewpoint. There's nothing profane in some sense. Thank you so much. Would you like to add something?
Yeah, since you talked about the polytheism, which it might be or might not be an appropriate term, and you talked about in ancient texts, the question is asked, how many gods are there? And you had the millions or the thousands, but I'm not sure you got to the end, which is, and God is one. So it's a simultaneity of oneness and plurality. And that's that concept of Bheda Bheda that I'm trying to get at. So there are particular trees, and particularity has great, great value. And yet that particular tree is really part of the larger life. Yeah.
Our next scholar is Dr. Margaret Barker, who we are so thrilled and honored to have with us today. Dr. Barker has developed an approach to biblical studies, now known as temple theology. Dr. Barker read theology at the University of Cambridge in England, went on to pursue her research independently. She was elected president of the Society for Old Testament Study in 1998 and edited the Society's second monograph series published by Ashgate. She has so far, 17 books, which form a sequence, later volumes building on earlier conclusions. Since 1997, she has been part of the symposium Religion, Science, and the Environment, which has been convened by His All Holiness Bartholomew I, the Ecumenical Patriarch. This work has led her to develop the practical implications of temple theology as the basis for a Christian environmental theology. In June 2008, Margaret Barker the DD by the Archbishop of Canterbury in recognition of her work on the Jerusalem Temple and the origins of Christian liturgy. This has made a significant new contribution to our understanding of the New Testament and opened up important fields for research. Dr. Barker is a mother and a grandmother, a Methodist preacher, and was involved for over 30 years with the work of Women's Refuge.
Well, is this working? Can you hear me? Excellent. It's lovely to be here. It's my sixth time in Logan, and I'm sure it gets better every time. So it's really nice to be here, and it's lovely to be invited to speak at this very special conference. Is this not working?
Could you hold it?
I've got to hold it much closer. Hold it right like that. Okay. I'm going to talk to you about creation theology in the Bible, which has been much neglected, and I underline those two last words. I'm not going to use projected pictures, I'm going to give you six word pictures and then a little conclusion. So the Bible has a beautiful and sophisticated account of the creation and the role of human beings, but this is not set out in a single text. Both in the biblical stories of creation and in the design of the Jerusalem temple, There is a single vision of the relationship between time and eternity, between God and creation, between the visible world and the invisible world of God and the angels. To understand what the Bible says about the creation, we too must glimpse the vision that informed the worship of the temple, the poetry of the Hebrew prophets, the sayings of the sages, and the images of the storytellers. All express and honor the same truth about the creation. And since the New Testament shares this view of the creation, it is the basis of Christian belief about the environment. The first picture, the temple in Jerusalem, represented the creation. The Genesis story of the 6 days of creation also described the ceremonial building of the tabernacle described in Exodus chapter 40. Each stage in building the temple corresponded to one of those days of creation. The later temple was a larger version of the tabernacle built in stone. It was in two parts divided by the great curtain which represented matter. This was woven from four colors to represent the four elements. White represented the earth, blue the air, red the fire, and purple the water. The outer area of the temple represented the visible material world, the Garden of Eden, and the inner part was the Holy of Holies, the invisible world of the glory of God and of the angels. The curtain represented matter concealing the glory of God from human eyes. But the Holy of Holies in the heart of the temple showed that God was at the heart of creation. All temple worship concerning the relationship of the creation to God, praise, thanksgiving, asking for forgiveness. All temple worship concerned the relationship of the creation to God and to the world. The visible world was thought to be a temple where human beings were the priests. Adam, the name simply means a human being, Adam was put into the temple to serve it and to preserve it. Two Hebrew words which also mean lead the worship of the temple and preserve the teachings. Adam was described as the first high priest, showing that the role of the human being was to lead the praises of the creation offered to the Creator. Adam is often described these days as the steward of creation, but that is not a biblical image. That is a very Protestant business image. Adam was the high priest. After 6 days, God rested on the seventh, the Sabbath, showing that when the creation was complete and very good, nothing more was made. The goal of creation was not more and more, but sufficiency, completion, and rest. We can see from John's Gospel, when Jesus healed the man at the pool of Bethsaida, he was working with his Father on the sixth day towards a state when everything would be very good. The creation was not yet completed, and Jesus was engaged with his Father on that task. This is John's Gospel, chapter 5. The second picture, the whole creation, heaven and earth, was bound together in a network of bonds known as the eternal covenant, where eternal means the timeless but constant presence of God, and the eternal covenant joined all things to this timeless state. This was the covenant that God made with Noah, and its sign was the rainbow. This is Genesis chapter 9. It was also known as the covenant of peace, where peace translates the Hebrew word shalom, which means wholeness, integrity, everything as God intended it to be. The covenant of peace, the Berit Shalom, describes this state. In the time of Jesus, this covenant was called the covenant of steadfast love, and that word in Hebrew is chesed. The prophet Hosea shows that this covenant was first given to Adam, but he broke it, and his people had done the same ever since. A quotation from Hosea chapter 6, "I desire steadfast love and the knowledge of God, but like Adam, they transgressed the covenant." For Adam, the result of losing his relation, the result of breaking the covenant, was losing his relationship with the fruitful land. Genesis chapter 3, "Cursed is the soil because of you." Jesus said that keeping this covenant was the sign of being his disciple. Quoting John chapter 13, "By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another." Everything, the visible natural world, the human society, and the invisible world of the angels, was part of this one system created by God. The bonds of chesed held everything together and joined the visible world to God at its center. Any action which broke the bonds was called sin, and so human conduct could and did destroy the system. Sin could be deliberate or through ignorance. The effect was the same. One of the key roles of the priests and of the angels was to teach about right conduct. Breaking away from God was not seen as liberation, but as deprivation, losing touch with the source of life and renewal. The Jewish mystics described the Holy of Holies as the mystery of existence, the mystery of becoming, how all things came into existence. And a Christian gospel not in the New Testament, the Gospel of Philip, said that the veil of the temple concealed how God controlled the creation. When the bonds of the covenant were broken, the whole system collapsed. The vivid pictures in the apocalypses warned what would happen as the result of human sin. Stars would fall from the sky, the sun would lose its light. The prophet Jeremiah used less colourful language, but he spoke clearly of this same situation. "When people are skilled in doing evil," he warned, "they are stupid and do not know God. Then the earth will return to chaos, the state before God created order. It would once again be waste and void," the traditional words at the beginning of the story of creation in Genesis. This is from Jeremiah chapter 4. The broken covenant was repaired by atonement when the temple and the creation it represented was purified from the acts of sin, which incidentally was described as pollution. It was purified from the acts of sin and was recreated. Atonement involved repentance and self-sacrifice. Self-sacrifice is a very important element of this system. Repentance and self-sacrifice to renew and restore everything that had been damaged. Not only the person's relationship to God, but also the whole creation. An ancient poem says that when the Lord comes on the day of judgment, he will heal and restore the soil of his people. This is Deuteronomy chapter 32. The third picture. The Holy of Holies, the invisible presence, is a unity because God is one. This unity underlies and binds together in one system everything in the visible creation. The prophets glimpsed this in their visions, and the sages warned that when people lost sight of it, everything disintegrated. And the famous lines in the book of Proverbs, chapter 29, verse 18, "Where there is no vision, the people unravel." People on earth were able to learn something about God from the angels whose name means messengers. They were themselves part of the glory and unity of God. The song of the angels symbolized the harmony of all creation centered on God. And when people on earth praised the Creator, they joined with the angels in their music and became part of the great pattern of creation. The harmony and the shalom of creation were maintained by the obedience of the angels, and humans had to be obedient to God if they were to preserve the creation. The Christians knew that they were angels on earth, and they called themselves the Holy Ones, the saints. The fourth picture. The pattern of creation is determined by God. The pattern is described as the statutes or the engraved things. When earth is in harmony with these divine statutes, the natural world and human society enjoy justice and righteousness, words describing the state of peace. The prophet Isaiah depicted this state when the covenant was restored. This is the famous lines from Isaiah chapter 33. The Spirit is poured upon us from on high, then justice will dwell in the wilderness, righteousness abide in the fruitful field, and the effect of righteousness will be peace. The exact measurements and proportions and roles of everything are planned by God, and these are known as the mysteries of the creation. They are not simply cosmic dimensions, but include fair dealing in weights and measures. Progress is not a part of this picture. The aim is to keep everything in harmony with the plan of the ruler of the creation. And so we say in the Lord's Prayer, "Thy kingdom come," which means, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." The fifth picture. Humans were created as the image of God on earth. And so there was no statue in the temple in Jerusalem. People worshipped God by their treatment of other human beings and by their care for the creation. Jesus taught in his parable of the sheep and the goats, Matthew chapter 25, "If you did it for one of the least of these, you did it for me." Humans as the image also meant that people had to care for the creation in the way that God cares for the creation. Genesis says that Adam was created from dust, but began his real life when the Lord God breathed into him. He was put into the Garden of Eden to serve God and to serve the garden. But he was forbidden to take the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, secular knowledge. All other trees, including the tree of life, were permitted. The tree of life was the tree of wisdom, and this had been planted as Adam's food. But in the old story, Satan, described as the deceiver because he made forbidden knowledge look attractive, persuaded Adam and Eve to eat the forbidden fruit, and they discovered the consequences of secular knowledge, materialism and reductionism. They became no more than the dust from which they had been made, and they could not live in the presence of God. They left the Garden of Eden. The sixth picture, the tree of life was the symbol of wisdom, that God-given knowledge which binds all creation in harmony to the Creator. Some angels, known in the story as the sons of God, rebelled against God and brought their heavenly knowledge to earth, but without the law of God. They corrupted the creation by teaching secular knowledge, which fragmented and destroyed. Theirs was a deceptive, false covenant, offering a freedom that led only to death and decay. St. Paul taught that the Christians were the new sons of God, who were to free the creation from these bonds of decay and restore the covenant of shalom. And in the book of Revelation, St. John learned that faithful Christians would again eat from the tree of life and be restored to Eden. The seventh, which is not really the picture, but it is the great commandment, there is only one God, and to worship anything else is idolatry. An idol in this system is anything man-made, not just a statue. It can be an economic or a political system. Today, the market or the state is all too often worshipped as a god. Idolatry gives a false center to the creation, which warps and distorts the whole system. The second of the Ten Commandments warns that idolatry results in iniquity, and that Hebrew word means distortion, and this distortion affects several generations, not just those people who institute it. The gist of the second of the commandments is the Lord brings the distortions of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generation. In his great vision of the day of judgment in the book of Revelation, St. John heard heavenly voices proclaiming the kingdom of God on earth. And this is what they said: it is the time for destroying the destroyers of the earth. This aspect of the kingdom is too often neglected. And then St. John saw the Archangel Michael and his angels fighting against Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. And so the battle for Christians is against those who destroy the earth and who deceive with false knowledge and false promises. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Barker. Do any of our panelists have questions or comments for Dr. Barker?
Dr. Barker, thank you for that very interesting presentation. This is following on with the conversation that the two of us have had earlier. Could you talk a little bit about the power of translation and mistranslation in terms of the effect that it has on how biblical passages are interpreted? You said some wonderful things about this earlier, and I'd like to hear a little bit more, considering the fact that you've done so much work in the area of translation and getting down to the specific language of the text, and you've quoted so much here from biblical passages.
Right, is this thing still working? Oh, it's this one, right? This is it's like a comedy show running around with a mic, isn't it? There has been mistranslation of the Hebrew text of the Old Testament, and one or two significant unfortunate choices for translation in the New Testament. I can give a more detailed example when I have been reunited with my Bible down there, maybe later on in the day. But the pictures we have, for example, of Adam set in the Garden of Eden, and the picture is that he's put there to till it and to keep it. That's Genesis chapter 2. And you have pictures in Christian art of Adam with his spade and his fork, and Eve busy with her spindle and so forth. But the original picture, those original words, are not agricultural words at all. They're technical terms for serving in the temple, leading worship, preserving the tradition. So that's one very, very obvious example. There are many, many more. The one that is most critical in the New Testament, I think, was Martin Luther's translation of the Greek word ktisis in Romans chapter 8. And that can mean an individual creature, an individual human being, or it can't mean the whole creation. And the way Luther translated it, he gave the impression that St. Paul was talking about the Christian message as being simply the liberation of the individual human being and the restoration of the individual's relationship to God. Whereas if you look at the meaning of this Greek word ktisis in St. Paul's time and the way that was understood in the earliest Christian writings, you will see it meant the whole creation. And so the Christian message was restoring the relationship between the whole creation and God. And I suspect that Luther's choice of word, making it focus on the individual human being, has influenced adversely the Protestant attitude to creation theology. It's been very much an emphasis on a personal relationship with God rather than the relationship, excuse me, of the whole creation. And there are many, many examples like this where simply the translation of the Bible, which was made for the best possible reasons, with the knowledge available at the time, and we now know that that perhaps was not the best and the most representative translation of the thought of the writer.
Thank you very much, Dr. Barker. Our next speaker is Dr. George Hanley, who comes to us from Brigham Young University after having spent several years at Northern Arizona University. His graduate training was at UC Berkeley in comparative literature, and he focused on the literature of the Americas. While there, his publications include two books on inter-American themes. The first, Post-Slavery Literatures in the Americas, is a study of the representation of slavery and family history in novels from the US and the Caribbean. The second is New World Poetics, Nature and the Adamic. Am I saying that correctly? Adamic. A derivative of Adam, is that right? Very good. The Nature and the Adamic Imagination of Whitman, Neruda, and Walcott. This is a critique of the imagination of nature in inter-American poetry. Dr. Hanley has also co-edited Caribbean Literature and the Environment, Stewardship and Creation, LDS Perspectives on the Environment, and Postcolonial Ecologies. His book, Home Waters, A Year of Recompenses on the Provo River, is a work of creative nonfiction that includes nature writing, personal and environmental history, and reflections on ecotheology. He's currently working on a book, From Chaos to Cosmos, Literature as Ecotheology. He's serving as the Associate Dean of Brigham Young University's College of Humanities, Comparative Arts and Letters. Formerly, he was a chair of the Department of Humanities, Classics, and Comparative Literature, and directed study abroad programs to London in 2006, the Caribbean in the summer of 2009, London in the spring of 2013, and he is the advisor to the student club Echo Response. Also, Dr. Hanley is quite active in many civic activities, including a recent election to the Provo Town Council. Dr. Hanley.
You can hold this, or you could use the mic stand. Well, I just need to advance a couple of these. So thank you so much. I'm so honored to be here and grateful to be on this wonderful panel of distinguished scholars. Two of whom are new to me. I did meet Margaret Barker this summer in Greece and consider her a friend, and I'm grateful to be on the panel with her, and grateful to be with my old college friend, Alan Matheson, who we go back quite a way. Grateful and honored to be a part of this with him and for the work he's doing. And I very much look forward to hearing from the panel of religious leaders later this afternoon, and I'm grateful for Elder Snow's presence here. As a Latter-day Saint myself, I'm looking forward to hearing from him. The presentation today is essentially part of two different research projects that are emerging. One is a book that I've co-authored that will be appearing later next year on climate skepticism. UK, France, and Germany, and another is a book of essays about Latter-day Saint belief and stewardship that will be published later in 2019 or maybe 2020. Climate change has presented many challenges to our capacity and willingness to respond. In diagnosing some of the reasons for these challenges, as I attempt to do here from a Latter-day Saint perspective, I do not pretend that there are any of us who are without sin, as it were. To some degree or another, we all willingly push aside the disturbing facts of climate change and continue to contribute to the problem. The only way I know how to find meaningful change in my own life as a member of my faith is through repentance. And repentance requires recognizing the mistakes I have made, understanding the roots of those mistakes, and finding a reason for hope to believe that I have the necessary resources to make a change.
So this presentation is an attempt to provide a brief gloss on what I consider to be the roots of climate change skepticism, as I've studied it both in nationally in terms of different religious experiences, but also in the Latter-day Saint context, and what I believe are some resources that can motivate meaningful change. Much of what I will say about skepticism is not unique to the phenomenon known as Mormonism, but I will argue that Latter-day Saints have more than sufficient grounds for believing in and caring about climate change. I will not have the space here to provide specific examples, but will be giving an overview of principles. Climate change presents a number of unique challenges to Americans in general and to Latter-day Saints in particular. I will outline first a variety of political challenges that I will then describe are exacerbated by certain cosmological challenges. Even though studies show that views of climate change today are more directly dictated by partisan affiliation than by religion, it is the religious overtone to the reaction that has made change more difficult. So here first are four, four political challenges. The first is the choice of faith over secularism. Because climate change is assumed to be a cause that emerges from such secular institutions as higher education or the international bodies such as the UN, mainstream media, and large scientific societies, the alarms that they are raising about the fate of species and oceans and watersheds are often deemed to be inaccurate or of little concern. In other words, in our cultural moment, different epistemologies are imagined to be mutually exclusive and in direct competition with one another. So it is, again, a choice of either faith or secularism, and faith is chosen. Although Latter-day Saint theology is science-friendly and promotes civic engagement, suspicions remain about the rising threat of secularism. Secondly, people, not trees. Although there is nothing inherently liberal or conservative about the reality of climate change, and although it has enjoyed brief moments of bipartisan support, attitudes today are often polarized by what are also perceived to be dueling and mutually exclusive concerns about either the human economy and concerns about the ecological economy. This polarization has meant that climate change appears to force the choice between the spotted owl and the logger. And I will note that Utah has proliferated tree hugger and rock licker is a phrase in Utah. I don't know if that has any relationship to Hinduism or not, but squirrel squeezer and so on. Much of the resistance to climate change mitigation among conservatives has come from concerns about the costs of mitigation. Even when they assume climate change is real and human caused, skeptics will often insist that mitigation is both too costly to the economy and too ineffective. And I'm not weighing in on those questions. I'm simply pointing out the source of the resistance. In a strongly family-centered theology like we find in my faith, it is a hard sell to worry first about more than human life. Third, American exceptionalism and not internationalism. Climate change has exposed the urgent need for international collaboration, and this is one reason, and I would say interfaith collaboration. And this is one reason why isolationists and those who feel especially strongly about American exceptionalism are often more inclined to bristle and actively resist suggestions for the need for such collaboration and any related compromises. For Latter-day Saints, I don't necessarily think there's any theological grounds for one position or the other, but such political inclinations are additionally bolstered by the fact of the religion's origins in this country and readings of the Book of Mormon that claim special status for the United States alone. The Book of Mormon is germane to all of the Western Hemisphere and not uniquely to the United States, but the tendency has often been for nationalistic readings, which are a product of the initial impulses of what was once a predominantly American membership. Number four, individual freedom, not regulations. Climate change has, as yet, not resulted in smaller government. The cry instead has been not only for international treaties, but for broad and sweeping regulations or taxes that can quickly shift the economy away from fossil fuels. It is not entirely clear that climate change makes larger government inevitable, however. And until and unless conservatives get serious about identifying conservative solutions, we'll probably never know. But the point is that for those already disposed to believe that smaller government is categorically better government, and that regulations are obstacles in what is an otherwise smoothly operating free market system that is best left alone, climate change is a bitter pill to swallow. Because so much emphasis is placed on individual accountability and the need to protect free agency in their theology, Latter-day Saints readily share conservative suspicions of the dangers of big government and international treaties. This distrust has also been shaped by the historical experience of fleeing persecutions at the hands of state and federal governments. Today, in many of our rural communities in Utah, federal policies can sometimes exercise a disproportionate influence on local lifeways and economies. So that's the end of my sort of political discussion, but what makes these obstacles even more challenging is that deeper, more cosmological beliefs have imbued these political leanings with theological weight, thus hardening the resistance to the reality of climate change. And I believe this explains why people often resist claims about the climate, not merely out of political preference or honest disagreement about science, but with a kind of cosmological urgency. When the phenomenon of climate change appears to undermine the very existence of the universe as one imagined it to be, it is not hard to understand why one might then deny it, as if one's very existence depended upon that denial. Indeed, it is often suggested that it isn't happening because one's theology suggests that it can't happen. You may have heard people like James Inhofe or Sarah Palin, Pat Robertson, or others make such arguments. So here are four cosmological challenges that have contributed to such resistance. First, accountability. The moral urgency of the climate crisis notwithstanding, scholars have noted that climate change challenges traditional conceptions of ethical responsibility. Climate change is a global phenomenon that is measured by global averages that are the result of millions of individual contributions of carbon emissions over many generations. Even though we can measure carbon footprints of individuals, corporations, and even nations, it is difficult, if not irresponsible, to argue that all emissions are equally suspect morally. For example, measuring emissions alone cannot distinguish between an individual act of driving a sick person to the hospital or a comparable drive to yet another round of golf. It cannot distinguish between an American flying to Hawaii for vacation or a comparable flight of Syrian refugees to the U.S., or between a military conflict and a humanitarian effort that emit the same amount of carbon. When it comes to emissions, there is, in short, no clear and proportionate relationship between intention, action, and consequence. In the Latter-day Saint tradition, individual agency and accountability are deemed centrally important to our individual development. We are used to thinking of our use of individual agency as something that can be judged in terms of its direct consequences. Secondly, temporality. If we can't see the damage of climate change, or if making amends will never be seen in a lifetime, the urgency to make amends is harder to feel. This has been widely studied by psychologists and philosophers. But to properly understand climate change, we need to have a sense of deep time and the Earth's long history, and we need to place within the sphere of our moral concern a future that extends at least to the next 20 to 100 years, if not farther. We have either lost or not yet developed such a moral imagination. And the challenge is that such an imagination is needed most at a time when the short cycles of corporations' annual profit margins and of political elections have come to totally dominate our sense of urgency. I think what is perhaps especially challenging in this regard for Latter-day Saints is indicated in their name. While millennialism isn't unique to Latter-day Saints, it is particularly emphasized in our theology. A latter-day church understands itself to be unlimited time. It is unfortunately not yet exceedingly rare or unheard of for a Latter-day Saint to wonder out loud, if the earth is going to die anyway, why bother taking care of it? Three, the human role in history. Now you can see that climate change starts to challenge some deeply held beliefs about the very moral fabric of the universe and its teleology. And I'm moving very quickly over some very complicated ideas here, but bear with me. Agency is more collective, climate change suggests that agency is more collective and stretched out over time, and perhaps more importantly, more tragic than we may have thought. Good intentions can go awry. I don't think anyone thought in the 1800s that fossil fuels would result in the problems that we have today. And perhaps more importantly, good intentions can go awry. Consequences are now more disproportionate to intentions. And thus, it isn't always clear which individuals bear the responsibility nor where we are headed. This seems to raise questions about God's sovereignty. In the wake of World War II, as American democracy, technology, and economy blossomed, we had come to believe in the almost limitless capacity of individuals and the almost limitless capacity of the earth to provide adequate resources for such potential. This was well suited to a Latter-day Saint theology which is optimistic and hopeful about the future, hopeful about science and technology, and trustful of God's purposes. As a relatively cheap and available energy source, fossil fuels became the energy source that fueled the revolutionary ideas of human development and freedom. To have to now reimagine it as a great threat means having to adopt a cosmology that is more vulnerable to tragedy, less certain about human destiny, and where it is possible for human societies to collapse because of collective structural problems that are not always directly or always attributable to human flaws. It also raises the question in the minds of many Latter-day Saints, if climate change is such a serious threat and we are so responsible, why haven't church leaders revealed anything about it? 4, the human role in nature. Climate change has stimulated a great debate about the human role in nature. Much criticism has been launched at Christianity for its overt anthropocentrism, and some have argued instead for a much more egalitarian or biocentric view of our place in the natural world. In what is becoming a cultural war, we have seen counter-assertions from Christians about the human right to exercise dominion over the earth, which is another translation issue, I'm sure. In a religion that places such strong emphasis on God's plan for humankind as his offspring, and that suggests that the creation was intended for human habitation and human experience, as we strive to have families and build communities, there is often little tolerance for a biocentric kind of argument. Latter-day Saints often understand stewardship to imply the responsibility to develop and even redeem untouched land, but less often the need to, say, protect wilderness or species. Moreover, because climate change has raised concerns about population, the Latter-day Saint value of protecting the freedom of a couple to choose the size of their own family has also seemed to be in jeopardy. For many Latter-day Saints, there is, quote, enough and to spare, which is a phrase from Doctrine and Covenants, section 104, according to God's promises, and that means environmentalism contains a lot of overblown worry. When faced with these obstacles, it is tempting to conclude either that climate change is not real, or that Latter-day Saint faith tradition is utterly inadequate to meet the challenges of climate change and should be discarded. And this is unfortunate, not only and wrong, but it is an utterly ineffective strategy for making change possible. If climate activists want to enroll more people, they ought to be careful not to adopt diagnoses that blame or shame worldviews for being wrong, and instead assist and encourage traditions to identify values and beliefs that can motivate believers, the kind of imaginative reconstruction that you were talking about. This is the value of the eco-theological work we are doing here. Because such work accepts the reality of a problem, recognizes that a tradition up to the present has not yet been adequate to it, but nevertheless accepts the reality of the problem and believes, hopefully, that the tradition can rise to the challenge, I believe that is faithful work, in that it sees traditions as dynamic and revelatory rather than static and ideological. Latter-day Saints should recognize that a belief in continuing revelation, which is central to Latter-day Saint theology, is not merely hope for new teachings from the prophets, but also for new ways of imagining, rethinking, and repurposing what has already been revealed. When we consider that a root meaning of the word religion is to reread and rethink, we are reminded that one does not have to forsake one's religion just to confront a problem that had not been anticipated. I was fascinated that it's a similar problem in Buddhism. Traditions prove their relevance and vitality by reimagining themselves in the face of unprecedented challenges. By contrast, adherents risk contradicting the very tradition they seek to defend by faithlessly denying a reality that will not go away. So briefly, in conclusion, in the interest of symmetry here, I have only proposed four reasons Christians and Latter-day Saints in particular should care about and respond to the challenges presented by climate change. There are many more, and maybe Elder Snow will elucidate more of those later today. First, the sanctity of human life. Climate change presents particular dangers to the world's poor, who, because of economic and ecological vulnerabilities, are more likely to be devastated by changes in temperature, sea levels, and weather extremes. Taking care of the poor is a very high priority in Latter-day Saint belief, so much so that in the same verse where the Lord promises that there is enough and to spare, he commands, however, that the distribution of resources must be done in mine own way, or else we risk damnation. That way, the Lord explains, is through what is known as the law of consecration, whereby those with more than they need give to those who have less. When we consider that environmental problems are problems of distribution of resources, this is a valuable principle. Secondly, the sanctity of biological life. Anthropocentric beliefs need not result in indifference to non-human life. Such indifference contradicts our love of human life in any case. And I think no one's been more articulate than on this point than the Pope Francis. There is no room for believing we have to choose between the spotted owl and the logger. Besides, Christians believe God created a world he pronounced good long before humans even showed up and commanded not only humans but plants and animals to multiply and replenish. Latter-day Saints believe, moreover, that all of life is intended to fulfill the measure of its creation, which includes joy and rejoicing in posterity. We hold firmly to the idea of the sanctity of human reproduction, and therefore take great care to ensure proper moral treatment of sexuality. I see no reason to believe that the earth's reproductive capacities that have given life to every living thing, and to human life in particular, should not be similarly safeguarded as sacred. Abuse, promiscuity, greed, and commodification of our life-giving sexual powers are deemed sinful. So why can Latter-day Saints not also imagine that abuse, promiscuous and greedy consumption, and commodification of nature are likewise sinful? If climate change threatens the Earth's remarkable capacity to regulate the climate that has made our human civilization possible and that has allowed a stunning flourishing of all of life, why should the fact of our impact on the climate not be regarded with utmost seriousness? Three, sanctity of future generations. The great prophecy of Malachi, which lies at the very heart of the restoration, states, quote, Elijah shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children and the heart of the children to the fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. The fate of the earth, in other words, appears to lie in the balance if we don't live with greater respect for and awareness of the past and the future. An ethics of presentism will simply not do. Latter-day Saint belief makes it clear that if we aspire to live in God's kingdom without the due consideration of our impact on future generations, we will not end up deserving a place in the very kingdom we hope is coming. In other words, Latter-day Saints are simply trying to earn the right to remain, or at least return, to earth, which is, in Latter-day Saint theology, the site of the celestial kingdom. As Pope Francis has reminded us, if families are important, then protecting communities and their relationship to the natural world and safeguarding future generations is vital to the protection of the family. Since this earth was created for us as a home to intentionally and willfully leave the world more uninhabitable for future generations would be a sin of enormous proportions. Finally, freedom, sanctity of freedom. I have no argument with the need to preserve freedom. I do have an argument with a belief that freedom is an end in itself and is more important than responsibility. A narrow definition of individual accountability that shrugs off concerns about responsibilities to the broader human and biotic communities upon which we all depend is not accountable at all. Let's be clear, no one is free if one cannot sustain oneself and one's family. I'm not preserving freedom if my capacity to sustain myself is used to glut myself on the earth's resources while others are increasingly compromised in their ability to do so.
I might be free from debt by becoming more financially and temporally self-reliant, but if that self-reliance is an end in itself and excludes a recognition of our interdependence among all living things and ignores the decreasing freedoms of others, my self-reliance is merely an excuse to ignore my debt to others, to nature, and to God. My children and grandchildren and others across the world are less free if they have fewer choices about where and how to live because of my choices. The market is not free if I cannot choose clean and renewable energy or less impactful goods and services such as affordable and healthy local produce or public transportation, or if I cannot see the real cost of what I am purchasing. And let's remember that these kinds of protections require good policy and proactive government. And let's remember that freedom is only meaningful where there is diversity, genuine choice, and collective responsibility for our common home of the earth. In conclusion, climate change is a challenge but also an opportunity for religious people to dust off their own theology and awaken ourselves to the wonder and responsibility nature inspires. The fact of the creation is of such magnitude and importance, it is no wonder that every prophet in the scriptures insists that all ethics begin by remembering that we are created and subjects to a creator. I believe that confronting climate change in this way is what in the Christian concept and Latter-day Saint understanding describes as making our weaknesses strong. If our weakness, if there's a weakness in our climate and a weakness in our own culture of doubt and denial, by rising to this challenge, I believe that hope becomes possible. Wondering why we should take care of the earth is like wondering why, if we are going to die, we should bother being concerned about life at all. I find such attitudes profoundly irreligious, and my hope is that our American and Latter-day Saint culture can change to such a point that we would all feel our collective failure the next time somebody wonders why we should care. Thank you.
I'd like to say, ask if any of our panelists have any questions or comments for Dr. Hanley.
Thank you so much. That was really very powerful, very informative. I've learned quite a bit, even with such a short talk. But I also, what I really appreciate is the identification of the challenges and recognizing that there are reasons and motivations for why people do deny climate change that can be both political and cosmological, and then your response to try to find, again, back to that idea of interpreting things for the current situation, and really grounding it again in core values of the LDS. I also had to remark to myself about some of the key concepts that came up that are also found in Buddhism, even though obviously they play out in practice in very different ways. But the independence of all living things is a core concept in Buddhism as well. And I think that also echoes in what Dr. Barker was talking about of that reinterpretation of the word for by Luther. It's not the individual, but all creation, and having the very strong religious roots. So, that echoes again in Dr. Habermann's talk. So I think we're finding some very interesting parallels in four very different traditions, and that there are ways of sharing these values and building on them that are very common and can help give us the hope. So I appreciate your closing. Thank you very much. It's not really a question, it's just thank you.
Yeah, I also, that on? Yeah. I also appreciated so much of what you had said. I have not known a great deal about the Latter-day Saint tradition, and to hear this has been educational for me in ways I greatly appreciate. I wrote down and was just struck by the phrase that you used that often is said, and particularly your focus on temporality and the concept of big time versus small time. And corporate time is there in some sense, but all care really is care in the immediate present. So that in some sense, care itself requires a focus on small time. And yet, climate change is, as a science, asking us to think about much larger scales of time, and particularly time as we're looking into the future. So the concern with the sanctity of future generations, I think, is so valuable in thinking about that. But the phrase I wrote down that you says, if the Earth is going to die anyway, why take care of it? And in a sense, you answered my question, but I wouldn't mind hearing a bit more about it, because you could just change that to a baby. When we're holding a small baby in our arms, if we're aware at all, we're aware that that baby is going to grow up and die in, by geological time, a very short period. At best, we're talking about 100 years. So I suppose the question was going to be, what's the difference between holding a baby and saying the baby is going to die, why care for it, and the Earth? And you brought us back to that point at the end, and I guess I would appreciate hearing a bit more about that.
That's a great question, and a hard one to answer, but I think maybe going back to what you were saying about, you know, we make decisions in discrete moments of time, even if they are guided by concerns about future generations. There's always a kind of immediacy to our moral actions that I think is really valuable. And I know, you know, I sometimes my students get overwhelmed by climate change and my own children. and I'll say, look, you know, where my faith comes in is that where at least my trust in divine purposes is that I just know that I can only worry about what I do, you know, and how I might influence other people, but there are certain things I actually can't change. And you might say, well, you know, if you change your light bulbs and you start riding your bike to work more often, that's not going to make any difference at all. That's totally true. You know, in the long term, over time, one individual action that is course corrected is not going to make a big difference at all. But it feels good, and I think it actually starts to activate a kind of moral responsibility that a person needs to feel. No one likes to feel. I believe this wholeheartedly, that no one in their conscience likes to feel apathetic. I think they know that's wrong. And even when they throw out justifications, I think they know that it feels good to be, you know, making even small choices about how you eat or how you travel that can make a small difference. And the odd thing is that the human baby example, that was really what I was getting at. You know, Latter-day Saints know that they're not supposed to smoke and drink. And they know that from a time that if they've been raised in the church, they know that from very young. And so they know that the body is a gift, and that but they also know that the body's going to be resurrected and it's going to be perfected in resurrection. And not once have I ever heard anyone suggest, even with, you know, with any degree of seriousness, that we should forsake the responsibility to protect our bodies because we know we're going to get a clean one when it's all over. You would never say, well, I'm going to pollute my body all I want because I'm going to get a clean and cleaned up one later. Everyone in my tradition knows that that's wrong. But for some reason, when it comes to the global geological sense of responsibility, this sense of covenant to the whole of creation, it's really easy to suddenly fall into that logic. So I try to use that example. I haven't used the example of a baby, but I've talked about our own lives and I've talked about our own bodies and said, you don't use this logic with your own body. So why are you willing to use it with relationship to the creation? And would you feel comfortable talking to Christ as the creator when it's all over and thanking him for everything that he did because you polluted and he cleaned it up? Does that seem right to you? Of course it doesn't. I'm fascinated by this idea that the apocalypse and the millennium has something to do with sort of taking care of the destroyers of the earth. But I do think there's some reckoning to be done there. But I think it's a it's a weird sort of, and that's why I'm calling it kind of cosmological weakness. I think it's easy when the problem gets bigger to forsake responsibility because it's suddenly become too big. And I do agree that I think if we can bring it down to smaller bite sizes, it actually gets traction that way much more easily. I mean, I think Latter-day Saints would light up with energy about this if they saw the urgency about their own children, their own home economics being kind of the center of what we ought to do about the climate. I think it would be really fabulous.
Before I ask for a collective show of appreciation for our outstanding and excellent panelists, I'd like to remind people here that the books that these scholars and that the religious authorities who have gathered here today, the books that they have produced for us, some of them are available for you to peruse in the foyer. And there's also a book, for those of you concerned, a book that can be signed, where you can sign your name. For those of you concerned to stay in touch with us about this, this is the inaugural God and Smog Conference. We intend on holding more in the future. So please do put your name in the sign-in book. It's on the same table as the books to be perused. After we offer some applause to our panelists, we will have about a 15 to 20-minute break at 10 minutes to noon. We will gather back here and open the floor up to the public, to you all, for questions and comments. So first, let us offer our appreciation to our panelists. Thank you so much.